Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Tom Inglesby. I'm the Deputy Director of the Center for Biosecurity of the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. And I want to welcome all of you to this, I think, very exciting conference. We're very glad that you all have joined us, and we know that you're all busy, and we plan on making this a very worthwhile discussion. The purpose of this meeting is to take time to examine our assumptions and judgments about how to prevent or counter biological threats, and as much as we can constructively do, provide useful input to the policy community who is trying to make policy and run programs around these issues. We've gathered a very distinguished group of speakers and panelists, but it was not easy to choose because many of you in the audience could just as easily have been on these panels. Many of you in this room work on these issues day in, day out, and hopefully we will hear from many of you in the discussion today. A few comments on how the day is set up. It's divided into a few formal presentations, four panels, and a lunch discussion. For the formal presentations, we've asked our speakers to speak for about 20 minutes and to take about 10 minutes of questions and answers. Because those sessions, those question and answer sessions are relatively short, we're going to ask people to put their questions on note cards so we can try and combine them and ask as many questions as we can get through. For the panel presentations, we're going to operate a little differently. We've asked the panelists to speak briefly, 5 to 7 minutes apiece, and then we're going to have ample time for Q&A. And we have standing mics that will be turned on, and we would invite people to come up and make questions and have a discussion with the panelists about these issues. We're going to provide lunch for everyone at about 12:30, and it's a box lunch, but it is an elegant box lunch. So don't be disappointed by that. You'll be surprised. So we will have time to gather it, make calls, come back to our seats, and listen to a very engaging lunch discussion. And then at the end of the day, if you're still with us, I'd invite you all to come upstairs for a reception where we can continue to talk about these things. And I do want to thank the WMD Commission for co-sponsoring this and the Sloan Foundation for also making this possible, and Paula Osuski in particular, for her support of these efforts and this meeting. So to begin the discussion, let me give you four propositions to start the discussion. I'm gonna say what they are, and I'm gonna come back to them. The first proposition is that biological threats are a major national security issue and will continue to evolve over time. I don't think it's particularly controversial. I'll try and defend that. The second is that the nuclear model for prevention does not fit bio. Simple, and I'll try and explain that. The third is that there is a lot of value in us thinking clearly about the goals of a prevention strategy before we talk about the programs. Then we talk about the programs and see if we can actually feasibly get us to those goals. And last proposition is that no matter what prevention strategies we pursue, it's going to remain of fundamental importance to the country that we have a strong, effective biodefense that can minimize the consequences of biological threats. So let me go through these briefly. The first, biological threats are a major concern of national security. The knowledge to make biological weapons is widely dispersed in the world. There are no technological choke points. Pathogens and materials are accessible around the world. Pathogen production, aerosol dissemination, other technologies widely disseminated and used for agricultural and health purposes. Biological weapons have been used in the world on the smallest of scales in the anthrax attacks of 2001 and in larger scales and demonstration trials by the US in the 60s, by the UK, by the former Soviet Union. Many assessments, the World Health Organization, the Congressional Office of Technology Assessment, multiple US government studies have concluded in various words, but the same judgment, that absent a strong, effective response or an effective biodefense, the potential casualties from biological attacks could be in the thousands or many more. Biological weapons can be developed and are used by countries, terrorist groups, small unnamed groups that are not yet on our radar screens, and perhaps individuals. The latest national intelligence estimates say that bioterrorism is the greatest WMD concern of the intelligence community. Al-Qaeda had the intention and had tried to develop biological weapons in the past. Whether they will succeed or when, we don't know. So coping with the problem of biological weapons is of critical importance and will get only more so with the passage of time. The second proposition, the nuclear model for prevention does not apply to bio. Some of the key goals of the nuclear prevention framework: secure fissile material around the world, prevent the emergence of new nuclear states and nuclear testing using inspections, aerial photos, sophisticated seismic, hydroacoustic, radionucleotide monitoring, prevent the divergence of nuclear fuel into weapons, treaty arrangements, the NPT, Material Cutoff Treaty, the CTBT, all in pursuit of these goals, and maintain a deterrence through forensics, attribution, and the promise of retribution. In the main, these largely don't apply to bio. Obviously, there are some things that do and some things that don't. But biological materials can't be counted like fissile material. Pathogens are in labs and culture collections around the world, and increasingly they will be able to be synthesized de novo. Nuclear weapons and technologies are controlled by countries. Biotechnologies and materials are dispersed and not controlled by countries. You can't recognize a bioweapons lab from the sky. Bioscience facilities are heterogeneous, dispersed across the world, and are almost all dedicated to benevolent science and at improving health and economic well-being. There's been decades of work on nuclear forensics. Bioforensics is a much more new field, and we'll hear more about that today. So many in the prevention community still, either consciously or unconsciously, still think of the nuclear model when they think about bioprevention. I don't know that I would say that about many in this room, but certainly it's a widely held framework. But to put a period on it, from my point of view, and I think many in the room, the nuclear model doesn't fit for bio. So what should the bioprevention framework be? And that's going to be the discussion of today. So the third proposition, focus on goals before we talk about programs. Goals we might consider for a bioprevention framework, and that many are considering, certainly in government and out of government. Can we control biological pathogens, materials, or information in ways that slow biological weapons development or use? Can we improve transparency between countries on BW issues? Can we strengthen the moral and behavioral norms against BW use? Can we improve intelligence and interdiction? Can we improve surveillance and international collaboration on infectious disease monitoring and response? Can we improve forensics and deterrence? And finally, can we strengthen biodefense as a means of dissuasion and deterrence? For all of these, we need to ask, to what extent are these goals feasible? If feasible, how should we do this? What can we gain? And are there adverse consequences? Which brings me to the last proposition. No matter what prevention strategy we pursue, it will remain of fundamental importance to the country to build its resiliency against biological threats. An effective biodefense that can minimize the consequences of biological threats of the future. We have to acknowledge that whatever our prevention strategies going forward, they may and they may not succeed, no matter how wise or well executed. So we need to move forward both on prevention and on response.